Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Game of 100 Candles by Marie Brennan. Narrated by Kaipo, Schwab. Chapter 1. Tanchu's cool nose touched the side of Sekken's hand a moment before Amino's voice came through the door.
Little brother, the physician is here.
Surfacing from meditation, felt like coming down to earth, like a heavy court robe being draped over Sekken's shoulders. When he meditated, he could forget his body, with all of its demands and betrayals. He could become just a mind, and then not even that. A self that, for brief moments, forgot its own existence, like the Shinseists encouraged. Until someone interrupted, dragging him back to physical reality. Back to a world where his mother had found yet another physician to examine him, as if this one would have any more success than the half dozen who came before. Sighing, Sekken opened his eyes. Tanchu was at his side, alert and prick-eared, and Sekken scratched the dog's jaw. Thank you. Interruptions were more welcome when they came from his sister, but advance warning made them less jarring. Tanchu's tail thumped once against the tatami. Then he shifted out of the way as Sekken levered himself carefully to his feet, but not too far away, as if the dog could do anything should his master prove unsteady.
You're worse than my childhood nurse, Sekken grumbled, but Tanchu made no reply.
Brother?
Nothing, Amino. Tell mother I'll be there shortly. A soft rustle as his sister departed. Sekken rubbed his eyes and considered changing into something better than his current, informal kimono. But no. If his mother had brought another physician to poke at him, they would hardly expect formality, and Sekken wasn't minded to waste energy he might not have, just to look more polished. He felt solid enough on his feet as he slid the door open and stepped onto the veranda, but the cold air hit like a rebuke. Even with the winter shutters in place, closing away the sight of the gardens and sealing the veranda in dimness, there was a sharp difference between Sekken's brazier-warmed chamber and the atmosphere beyond his door. Tucking his hands inside the sleeves of his quilted robe, he hurried through his family's manor to the room where they greeted visitors. His mother was there already, seated with the physician while a servant poured tea.
Son, this is Sir Makusa Naotsugu. I sent for him after your difficulties yesterday.
My collapse, you mean. By now his mother was used to days where Sekken had to take a nap before lunch, then maybe another one after, waking up hardly more refreshed than he'd felt when he lay down. That level of difficulty was frequent enough that it hardly occasioned remark anymore. But yesterday had been one of the bad ones.
Lord Asako, Naotsugu bowed to him. I understand that none of the physicians you've seen have been able to offer much assistance, but I may be able to bring a fresh perspective.
You can try, Sekken said as he knelt, but forgive me if I don't hold out much hope. His mother's mouth thinned in reproof, and Sekken grimaced. Forgive me. I'm afraid my manners suffer alongside my health.
As is to be expected, Naotsugu said. Your lady mother gave me the history of your ailment. From the sound of it, your experience serving as a vessel for your honored ancestor, Kaimin Nushi, badly damaged your elemental strength. Naturally, this will be reflected in your inner capacity as well as the outer. If I might examine you,
Sekken pulled his wrist away when the physician reached for it. You may not.
Son!
He scowled at his mother. I know you mean well, both of you. But I'm tired of this, and it never produces any results. Some days I'm fine, other days I'm not. There's no pattern to it, and no predicting whether the day will be a good one or bad. I've taken medicines, I've prayed to the fortunes, I've practiced 16 kinds of spiritual techniques. None of them make more than a temporary difference.
It seems this is the price of what I did in Sabomura, and I simply have to live with that. The mutinous set of his mother's shoulders said she was far from ready to accept it. Sekken was her youngest child and her only son. His whole life he'd been the sheltered one, doted on by his parents, encouraged in his scholarly pursuits. With his sister's advantageous marriages and good positions, there had never been any need for Sekken to do more than glide through life, the privileged son of a fortunate family. Until 2 years ago, when that serenity suddenly cracked. Back then, his family's big worry had been hiding the fact that a dog spirit was haunting him. Sekken had left in pursuit of answers, and he came back broken. Naotsugu cleared his throat. By your leave, Lord Asako, Lady Asako, I shall answer your bluntness with my own. I understand that all your previous physicians have looked at your ailment from the perspective of your elemental weakness. I am more concerned with the spirit your lady mother says has attached itself to you. That startled Sekken out of the familiar rut of his thoughts. Tanshu? At his side, the dog sat up. Unlike Sekken, he'd recovered well from his nadir in Sabomura, when the dwindling of the ancient ward he helped maintain had all but drained the life from him. When he chose to exert himself, he could become visible and tangible to other people. But right now, only Sekken could see him.
The Inugami, yes,
Naotsugu said.
I know something of how such creatures are made. Through the greatest cruelty, starving a dog until it reaches the point of abject desperation, then cutting off its head.
Sekken slammed one hand against the floor. Stop. I've read the same scrolls you have, Sir Naotsugu. But unlike you, I've read a great deal more than that. I have no doubt that some heartless individuals have trapped the spirit of a dog in such fashion, forcing it to serve them. But that is not the only way. Like other animals, a dog can become an Inugami through attaining great age, and such creatures can agree to serve a human witch, and after that witch, their descendants. A moment ago, you referred to my honored ancestor, Kaimin Nushi. Now you turn around and suggest she was a horrible woman who tortured a dog. Which is it? Make up your mind. He fought to get his temper under control. This was, unfortunately, a side effect of being a witch. Such people were notoriously unstable in their behavior. He hadn't felt any instability in Kaimin Nushi on the two occasions when his body served as her vessel. But then, she'd been so great in life that in death, her soul transcended the underworld and became a minor deity. Sekken was just a layabout courtier who'd inherited her dog. Naotsugu's face had gone rigid and he bowed low.
Please forgive me, Lord Asako. I meant no slander to your ancestor, only to suggest that your tie with this creature may be contributing to your recurrent weakness. However it was bound, with whatever good intentions the bond was formed, it may be harming you now.
All the air went out of Sekken. Tanshu, harming me? The dog whined when Sekken looked at him. Certainly he was the picture of canine health, his cream and brown fur thick, his eyes bright. Could he possibly be feeding on Sekken's own energy? No. You know what price you paid and why. You just assumed you'd be able to recoup your losses afterward, but it doesn't work like that. He could tell these physicians the full story, all the details he held back. Maybe then he wouldn't have to suffer through their visits anymore. But that would mean telling his mother the truth. He'd meant to. When he wrote up his initial report, though, to be carried from where he was recuperating at Ryodo Temple back to Phoenix Clan lands, it had felt arrogant to put the focus on himself, on his own noble sacrifice. And scholar, Sekken might be, but he was courtier enough to know how the tale would be spun. Instead of Agasha no Isao Ryotora protecting Rokugan from the chaos and terror of the night parade, it would be all about how a valiant scholar of the Asako family
saved Rokugan and Ryotora alike, at terrible cost to himself. Ryotora had saved the empire. Sekken had only saved Ryotora. But he'd told his superiors that Kaimin Nushi had rescued the other man when Ryotora attempted to give his life to end the night parade, that Sekken himself had merely served as her vessel. It wasn't entirely false. Like Ryotora, and unlike Sekken, Kaimin Nushi had been capable of speaking with elemental spirits. Without her assistance, Sekken never could have fed half his strength to Ryotora, replacing what the other man had sacrificed. And for a time afterward, when the two of them rested at Ryodo Temple, he thought he would recover. He had recovered, a little bit. Back then, he didn't even have good days. Neither of them did. Except that every day was good when Ryotora was at his side. His mother leaned forward.
Son, do you need to lie down again?
The worry in her eyes cut to the bone. She hated seeing him like this, intermittently weak in body and mind. Even though her son had come home a hero, she would trade all his unexpected glory in a heartbeat if it would restore his health. Sekken couldn't stand the thought of her reaction if she knew the truth. She would hate Ryotora. She wouldn't mean to, but she would. I'm fine, he said, and managed to smile. Truly, I don't think it's Tanshu. But sir, Naotsugu, if you wish to examine him, I'll allow it. Just not today, please.
Not today, his mother echoed firmly. My son needs his rest.
Sekken remained where he was as his mother escorted the physician out. He wasn't as tired as he had been yesterday. Meditation was one of the few activities that seemed to revitalize him at all. Sekken had practiced it dutifully in the past. A samurai child could hardly grow up in Phoenix lands without absorbing the habit. But now he meditated daily, sometimes more than once a day. Still, he wasn't in a hurry to get up. It meant he was still sitting there when his mother returned. My apologies, he sighed. I can't even blame that on weakness. Not truly. I've just gotten very tired of trying and getting nowhere.
I know, but we can't give up.
His mother knelt at his side and covered his hand with her own. He gave her a rueful smile, more honest than the one he'd mustered before. You've done an admirable job of finding physicians with discretion, but keep summoning new ones to poke at me, and sooner or later the truth will get out. Her jaw hardened.
Not if I have anything to say about it.
People already wondered, he knew. Anyone who came back from dragon territory with such deeds in hand ought to be everywhere at court, toasted and feted and enjoying his newfound prestige. Instead, Sekken had spent much of the last year as half a recluse, trying to conceal his weakness. Samurai, even soft-handed courtiers, were not in the habit of admiring men who never knew when they would need to spend all day abed, too exhausted even to read. He felt his mother's weight shift, preparatory to rising, but then hitching short. Sekken frowned. What is it? Her reluctance was visible.
I don't want to tire you.
Let me judge what I'm capable of. Tell me. She let out a slow breath.
The Dragon Clan visitors arrived in town last night. Agasha no Isao Ryotora is here.
As much as Sekken wanted to bolt straight out the door, he knew better than to try. For one thing, his quilted kimono was a disgrace, not fit to be seen in public. Sekken wasn't fit to be seen in public, not when he hadn't bathed in several days. His manservant, Jun, helped him with that, then brought cosmetics to disguise the stamp left by yesterday's bout of fatigue. Rice powder helped with the bruised skin beneath his eyes, and a charcoal stick darkening his eyelashes drew attention away from the shadows below. Rouge for his lips completed the illusion of health. and if he was going out, he needed to fortify himself. One of the previous physicians had left instructions on a scroll longer than Sekken's arm. Nearly everything he ate and drank was dictated by that scroll. Ginger, when his fire became weak. Vinegar, when it was water that lagged. A prescription for every condition. Since his earth had failed him the previous day, it was a meal of roasted yams before he could be permitted to go anywhere. Once upon a time, Sekken had liked roasted yams, but even his favorites palled when he had to eat them. Nor was it only a matter of food. There was a 5-herb medicinal tea for him to drink, washing down a rolled-up pellet of delicate paper on which a prayer had been inked. More prayers to recite at the family altars, first to his ancestors, including Kaimin Nushi, then to the 8 great fortunes. Meanwhile, the servants scurried about, readying enclosed litters for himself and his mother. At least that last part wasn't a concession to Sekken's ill health. His family had too much wealth and influence to walk through the streets for a political visit, especially when those streets were knee-deep in snow. They would be carried in proper style. By the time Sekken was ready to leave, it was too late to catch Ryotora at the Dragon Clan embassy. The servant dispatched to notify the ambassador of their coming returned with the news that she'd already gone with her guest to the governor's palace. "Then, that's where we'll go," Sekken said, before his mother could suggest they wait. Her look said, "I hope you aren't making a mistake." But they'd had that conversation before, and there was no point in repeating it. She merely nodded and called for servants to carry their litters. Sekken was glad of the shelter as they headed through the gates of his family's mansion and into the city. The first real snowstorm of the winter had struck the previous day, and although the snow had stopped falling, the air was bitter and sharp. The swaying of the litter unsettled his stomach, but the pan of heated sand on the floorboards kept him warm. Hopefully, that would stave off a relapse. Because above all, Sekken could not allow Ryotora to discover how bad his health still was. Ryotora knew perfectly well what Sekken had done that night in Sable Mura, and neither of them had been fully recovered when Sekken went back to Phoenix Lands late the previous autumn. Parting had been a sweet ache. During their time at the temple, it had been easy to pretend that neither of them had any obligation to family or clan, that they could simply bask in each other's company and share the little details of their lives that the supernatural chaos of Sable Mura had given them no time to discuss. When Sekken left, before winter's snows could trap him there, he'd had every confidence of seeing Ryotora again, though hopefully sooner than this. But from that autumn until now, over a year later, their only contact had been through intermittent letters, and Sekken had taken great care to omit all mention of his problems from those letters. He remembered all too well how easily the peasant-born Ryotora could fall into a pit of insecurity, questioning his right to the status of a samurai, much less whether he deserved to have his life saved at such cost. And that was when he thought the cost had been a one-time payment. "Under no circumstances can I collapse in front of him," Sekken thought as the litter stopped and was lowered to the ground. Eventually, they'd have to talk about it. He was under no illusions that he could hide this from Ryotora all winter. But the way to introduce the subject was not by toppling over at their first meeting in more than a year. And that went double when the meeting was at the governor's palace. The journey there was a short one. Hardly any chance for Sekken to risk a chill. When they exited their litters, he found the governor's steward had ordered great braziers to be lit in the front courtyard. The flagstones were already shoveled clean of snow, and between the sunlight and the fires, not even traces of wet remained. Tucking his hands into his sleeves, Sekken followed his mother to the walkway outside the formal entrance. In the summertime, one could gauge how many people were waiting to speak with the governor by how many pairs of sandals sat in patient ranks. In the winter, however, servants whisked the shoes away to a nearby chamber, where another brazier kept them warm.
In the receiving room he found nearly a dozen samurai, two monks, and one well-connected merchant sitting or conversing in quiet tones. The official start of winter court lay only a few days off, and while the domain of a provincial governor could hardly match the glories of imperial winter court, or even that of the Phoenix Clan champion, which Sekken had suffered through twice, it was still an occasion for a great deal of political business. To his great disappointment, though, none of those waiting there were Ryotora. Sekken's mother bowed politely to the room, then glided across the tatami to where a familiar woman sat. Kyukai province lay close enough to the border with Dragon Lands to merit its own permanent envoy, a position Mirumoto Kinmoku had held for as long as Sekken could remember. A swordswoman born male, she was as resilient as good steel. In all that time, the only change he'd seen in her was a little more gray threading through her hair with each passing year. Sekken pitied whoever would eventually be assigned the task of suggesting to her that she might retire. Normally, Sekken liked talking to Kinmoku. The provincial governor, Asako Katahiro, was one of the strictest and most straight-laced men Sekken had ever had the misfortune of dealing with. Kinmoku, prone to earthy bluntness, tended to knock him off his stride. She often apologized for it, blaming her warrior training. But Sekken suspected that was as much performance as truth. Either way, it was entertaining to watch. And sometimes, she wielded it for the benefit of others. No sooner had Sekken and his mother made their greetings than Kinmoku nodded at him.
"I hardly imagine you've come here to see me, nor the Lord Governor. You'll find Isao in the garden."
"Thank you," Sekken said, barely pausing long enough to punctuate his gratitude with a bow before he bolted out the door. Chapter 2. Phoenix tastes in garden design differed from those in Dragon Lands. Although Phoenix territory lay every bit as far north, it wasn't as mountainous, gentling the harsh climate. They relied less on the stark beauties of stone and water, which could survive even the harshest freeze, and attended more to the elegance offered by bare branches and bushes draped in snow. Ryotora gazed at them, measuring his breathing. Despite the cold, he'd come outside to gather his wits. All too soon he would have to meet the governor of Kyukai province, and he was not ready. A year wouldn't be enough to prepare him. He'd had a year, but everyone had assumed the negotiations over Seibo Mura would be finished long before now. While the village lay close to the Phoenix border, it was still in Dragon Clan lands, and therefore fell under their authority. Yes, a Phoenix had been involved with the problems there, but that wasn't the same as giving them a claim to oversee its future. Except that, like the Shadowlands to the south, the Night Parade constituted a threat to the entire empire, a threat which had been contained once more, but it remained a matter of imperial concern. And the Phoenix, whose diplomatic position was stronger than that of the reclusive dragon, considered spiritual affairs everywhere in Rokugan to be their concern. They'd managed to sway some influential ministers, so the official mandate was that the two clans must arrive at a mutually acceptable solution. And Ryotora's mandate was to help ensure that solution protected his clan. When the door slid open behind him, he assumed it was Mirumoto Kinmoku, or one of the governor's servants, come to fetch him. He turned, an apology on his lips, and found himself facing a man both familiar and strange. The whole journey to Phoenix Clan lands, he'd imagined his reunion with Sekken. Not one version, but many. Would Sekken come to the Dragon Clan's embassy? Would Ryotora call on him at his house? Even meeting here at the governor's palace in half a dozen different ways, some of their reunions were amusing, others stiff with formality. One or two would have made them an instant scandal of the court. All of them featured the wrong man. Ryotora remembered Sekken as he'd been when they first met, in the headman's house in Seibo Mura. Polished, courtly, at least by the standards of a rural mining village. But that was Sekken on the road, away from the comforts and refinements of home. The man facing Ryotora now made the one he'd met a year ago look like a country bumpkin. His winter kimono was fine silk, pale blue with a snowfall of white embroidery dusting his shoulders and sleeves. His hair, shorn during the troubles, had only grown out to his upper back, and the pin holding part of it in a topknot was white jade, carved into an elegant curlicue. Charcoal and rice powder and rouge transformed his face into a cultured portrait, the face of a wealthy Phoenix courtier, instead of the scholarly enthusiast who'd let his own curiosity draw him into a battle against murderous yokai. Ryotora swallowed hard. It wasn't that he suddenly doubted his memories, or that he believed Sekken had become a different man in the time they'd been apart. But he'd only ever known part of that man. This beautiful, sophisticated creature was the rest, and Ryotora didn't know what to say to him. Sekken seemed equally lost for words. Had Ryotora himself changed so much? He didn't think so. His clothing was certainly finer, dark green silk instead of practical cotton. But compared to Sekken, compared to everyone who would be at this winter court, he was a boulder, dropped infelicitously in the middle of a well-sculpted garden, as he had always been. Ryotora, Sekken breathed, a smile breaking the porcelain mask of his face. His exhalation plumed in the cold air, and he tapped his chin with a folded fan he held. No, forgive me. You're Lord Isao now, aren't you? Congratulations on your higher rank. I know I said it in a letter, I think I said it in a letter. But still, better to say it in person. It's nothing, Ryotora said reflexively, bowing. An empty title, nothing more. My clan has not yet decided where I can best be of use. Nor mine. The rueful turn of Sekken's mouth was more familiar, though it carried a shadow Ryotora couldn't decipher. I think we made it hard for them. Warriors are easy. When they distinguish themselves on the battlefield, you promote them to command more people, or you put them in charge of a nicer castle. When courtiers do something politically useful, they get a more senior position in the bureaucracy. But what do you do with a lazy scholar who got himself mixed up with yokai? Give him somewhere more comfortable to laze about, I would think. By Ryotora's standards, that passed for witty banter. But this wasn't at all how he'd expected their first conversation to go. He wished, far too late, that they hadn't met here at the palace. The shadow flickered back into view before Sekken tipped his face up to the sky. If you arrived last night, you must have traveled through the worst of that storm. In hindsight, Ryotora had made a serious mistake. His eagerness to arrive in sheltered Plain City meant he ignored the signs of impending bad weather on the final day. After all, weren't the dragon proud of their ability to endure harsh weather? By the hour of the serpent, though, the sky had become a leaden plate, and soon after that the snow began to fall. He should have bowed to the storm and taken shelter somewhere, even if it was a farmhouse rather than an inn. But the road was well marked, with no cliffs to slip off in the gloom. And so they pressed onward, while Ryotora's hands and feet turned to ice. It had taken him half an hour to thaw out once they finally arrived. Rather than explain that, he only said, "Yes, we did." Sekken laughed. "Have you offended some great spirit of the sky that you get dumped on everywhere you go?" If Sekken had appeared courtly and elegant at their first meeting, Ryotora had appeared like a sodden puppy. "Not every time. Only when I'm arriving where you are. Perhaps the spirits are doing your bidding, Lord Asako." "Only one. And he doesn't control the weather. Can you see Tanchu still?"
"Tanchu?"
"The dog spirit. That's what I named him. Did I not mention that in one of my letters?" The rice powder made it difficult to tell if Sekken flushed, but the awkward shift in his weight suggested it.
I thought I had. I could have sworn I had.
Diplomatically, Ryotora said,
Likely you did, and I simply forgot. I'm glad to... Wait, you named your dog Cinnabar?
Now the flush was clear. Yes, well, sort of. It seemed fitting since it was the Cinnabar from Sable Muda that let him reach me. But then I thought, no. I want a name for him that will acknowledge the tie to my ancestor. And then I figured out that I could write Tanchu with a different first character, the one that means nativity or to be born. Ryotora stifled a smile as the explanation staggered to a close. Of course you did. For the first time since the door opened, it felt like he was standing with the Sekken he knew, a man for whom language was an endlessly fascinating puzzle. As if a veil had been whisked away, the Inugami appeared at Sekken's side. It was a sign of how much stronger Tanchu had become. In Sable Muda, Ryotora had needed prayers to be able to see him. When the dog trotted over for a sniff, he realized Tanchu was not just visible, but corporeal. Does he go everywhere with you? Ryotora asked, scratching behind Tanchu's ears.
Why not? His claws don't scrape the tatami unless he's manifested physically, and he doesn't need to eat or, well, you know. So there's no reason for him not to.
And people don't know if he's there or not anyway, unless I tell them. But they know about him?
Sekken's quiet laugh was another cloud in the air.
Oh, yes. Now imagine belonging to a clan and a family renowned for their intellectual curiosity, and you'll have some sense of what my life has been like this past year.
Ryotora had received glimpses in the form of the letters they exchanged. The sweep of a brush on a page, though, was irretrievably inadequate for everything they wanted to say. Ryotora had told Sekken the Agasha family daimyo rewarded his service with an estate in Kinenkan province. He hadn't said how unqualified he felt to manage any such thing. Such doubts shouldn't be committed to paper, not when a letter had to pass through countless hands on its way to the intended recipient. Samurai were supposed to be honest and trustworthy, but that didn't stop the clans from monitoring communication across their borders. They'd said nothing of their feelings for one another. In Ryodo Temple, it had been easy. The physician monks there believed in the healing benefits of nature, so the two of them spent long hours lying in various gardens, sleeping to restore their strength and talking when they weren't asleep. Their mutual weakness kept them from doing anything more than kissing. But it hadn't felt like it mattered. Surely there would be opportunity in the future. Then they separated. And during that journey from Dragon Lands, Ryotora's escort had briefed him extensively on the political landscape of Sheltered Plains City, including the efforts of Asako Sekken's family to pair him with a spouse suitable to his new prestige. The silence was stretching out, more awkward with every heartbeat. Then Sekken shook himself and said, How is Chie?
She's well.
Ryotora's tongue stuck to the roof of his mouth. He ought to say that everyone's attention had turned to his younger sister's marriage, since the oversight of mountain shrines was usually passed down within a family. It was important for Chie to have children, assuming she could. The declining fertility of the Dragon Clan as a whole made that more of a question than it should be. But anything touching on marriage felt like a bridge that might collapse if Ryotora stepped on it. Discussing Chie might lead to discussing Sekken's own marital prospects, and despite days of wrestling with that topic, Ryotora still didn't know what to say.
What of your father?
Sir Keijun has moved to your new estate.
Sekken managed the correction so smoothly, no one overhearing them would have even noticed. It wasn't public knowledge that Dragon Samurai had made a widespread practice of shoring up their own numbers by adopting peasant children. Ryotora's birth father, Masa, remained in Sable Muda with Chie. His adopted father, Isao Keijun, was the only one Sekken should refer to. Perhaps he'd known that caution was necessary. The door slid open, and an elegant woman who shared Sekken's pointed chin bowed.
Lord Isao, I presume. I am Asako Fumizuki. Please forgive my rudeness in interrupting you, but the Lord Governor will be ready to see you shortly, and I fear I must retrieve my son.
Lady Asako, I am honored to meet you at last.
Ryotora stepped back. The dragon had sent formal thanks to the phoenix for Sekken's assistance, but this was Ryotora's first opportunity to thank Sekken's family directly. They'd nearly lost their son, all for Ryotora's sake. But Sekken caught his elbow before he could kneel and lower his face to the floor.
There will be time for proper introductions later. You don't want to keep the Lord Governor waiting.
Lady Asako was too well controlled to raise her eyebrows at the presumptuous touch, and Sekken let go a moment later. Ryotora wanted to argue, but the open door was letting cold air into the palace, and behind Lady Asako, he could see Mirumoto Kinmoku waiting. This wasn't the best opportunity for them to talk anyway. Ryotora needed time to absorb the reality of this Sekken, elegant and courtly. Time to imagine interactions more suited to the confines of provincial winter court.
Perhaps you can visit us later, Lady Asako said, stepping aside. We would be honored to welcome such an esteemed son of the dragon.
I would enjoy that, Ryotora said, and with a bow to her and Sekken both, went to do something he did not expect to enjoy at all.
Rise, Lord Isao, Lady Mirumoto.
Ryotora straightened from his bow. He and Kinmoku knelt in the lower half of the reception room, just in front of the small step-up that demarcated the provincial governor's dais. The room glowed, the light of the lanterns reflecting off the gold-painted screens that lined the walls. The transom above the rise in the floor was intricately carved rosewood. So were the edges of the doors that concealed the governor's guards. The elegantly staggered shelves held lacquered boxes, a painted fan, and an agate statuette of one of the fortunes, while the incense burner below the scroll in the alcove was sculpted jade. Ryotora could only assume the calligraphy on the scroll was exquisite. He was hardly qualified to judge. The entire setup could not have made him feel more out of place had it been designed expressly for that purpose. He'd been in the formal reception room of the Agasha Daimyo precisely twice. First when he came of age and passed the final examinations for his training, and a second time after the events in Sable Mura. But as with gardens, dragon tastes in decoration lean toward the austere. Asako Katahiro was only a provincial governor, not even the daimyo of his family, and yet the sheer wealth on display here dizzied Ryotora. As did Katahiro's conversation, gliding through the opening pleasantries with sufficient ease that Ryotora hardly had to do anything other than say yes and no, not at all, and bow at the appropriate points. Sometimes Ryotora managed these kinds of encounters just fine. Other times he found himself tangle-tongued and bereft of words just when he needed them most. It didn't help that he knew courtiers did that on purpose, spinning the unwary around until they hardly knew where the earth was. But Kinmoku had warned him about Katahiro's favorite trick. Thanks to her, Ryotora caught the moment when the rhythm of the conversation wanted to push a "yes, of course" from his mouth.
"Forgive me, Lord Governor," he said instead. "I know there will be plenty of time later to discuss Sable Mura, but the shrine there already has adequate oversight."
Katahiro's expression didn't falter. It was neither friendly nor stern, just a pleasant, non-committal serenity. According to Kinmoku, he looked like that almost all the time. It took a great deal to push him over into open anger or sadness. And as for joy or amusement,
"I'm not sure I've ever seen him laugh for real," she'd said. "I don't mean he lies.
He just never lets go. Between you and me, I don't think he likes being governor very much. He's very, very good at it, though, so don't let pity lead you into carelessness.
Ryotora couldn't tell if he'd phrased his objection gracefully enough, but he knew it hardly mattered either way. Katahiro said, "A matter as important as the imprisonment of the night parade can't be trusted to an unlettered peasant girl."
"Of course not," Ryotora agreed, "which is why my clan arranged for her to be educated by a teacher from the Mountain Song Temple."
"A monk?" Katahiro scoffed. "It took a priestess to create the ward, and a priest to restore it. A ward that draws on all five elements, and no one has a greater understanding of such matters than an Ishiken trained by the Isawa."
This was the main point on which the agreement had stalled for the last year. Bad enough that the Phoenix wanted to be involved in Sable Mura. They wanted to send an Isawa. That family's knowledge and skill were surpassed only by their pride, their steadfast belief that no one in the Empire could handle spiritual threats as well as they could. And although the Dragon and the Phoenix were generally on cordial terms, there were still points of friction. An Isawa overseer would be dropped into a village of perfect land adherents, followers of a religious tradition the Phoenix had outlawed as heresy in their own territory. An Isawa overseer would be in a position to note just how badly the Dragon had declined, something Ryotora's clan was doing its very best to keep concealed. Even without those complications, an Isawa overseer would still be an outsider, someone from another clan coming to do what they believed the Dragon incapable of handling on their own. Ryotora was grateful for Kinmoku's coaching.
"He'll try to lure you into agreeing," she'd said as they prepared that morning. "He knows you're unused to the maneuvering of court, and you're the hero of Sable Mura besides. If he can get you to bend, even by accident, then we'll have to follow. But you can't offend him with your refusal either. That's also a lever he can use against us."
A path along a narrow ridge with a steep fall to either side. Ryotora clenched his hands, then relaxed them, hoping his sleeves hid the calming gesture. Courtiers, he feared, saw everything. "No one questions the wisdom of the Isawa, Lord Governor. I hope they do not question the wisdom of the Agasha either." Katahiro paused just long enough to make Kinmoku inhale audibly. Then he smiled, a courtier's smile, broad and no deeper than the surface.
"Of course not, Lord Isao. I meant only to welcome you to my city. Let us forget these matters for now. I'm sure Winter Court will give us ample time to discuss our clan's respective traditions."
All too much time. The path Ryotora had to walk wasn't merely narrow. It was littered with traps. He could only pray for the wit and agility to avoid them. Chapter 3. It didn't take Sekken long to realize that, however out of place he'd felt in Sable Mura, Ryotora had it twice as bad in the city. At least in a rural village, Sekken could take refuge in the comforts and protections afforded by his higher status. Though Ryotora's new rank elevated him over many of those at Winter Court, there were plenty more who yet stood above him, and at heart, he remained a plain-spoken man from a vassal family, more accustomed to tramping about the countryside in observance of his duty than enjoying the pleasures of courtly life. But Ryotora couldn't serve his clan by hiding in the Dragon Embassy. At Winter Court, especially, he needed to meet other people, to socialize and engage in seemingly frivolous pursuits in order to win goodwill. Since he had precisely zero experience with that, Sekken felt it was his bound duty to help. The problem was, he had to stop his own family from helping too. He couldn't avoid introducing Ryotora to them. His mother, of course, lived in the city, and two of his sisters, Ginsho and Amino, were there for the season. He was lucky it was only the three of them,
his father, his sister's husbands, and his other two sisters with their husbands were all scattered across Phoenix lands right now, attending winter courts elsewhere. Naturally, those who were around wanted to meet the man who'd been part of such a momentous event in Sekken's life, and report to the others on what they found. Under normal circumstances, the three of them would have been his allies. He could make introductions, then leave Ryotora in someone else's safekeeping when he himself wasn't available. Normal circumstances, though, didn't involve the risk that Ryotora would say, "Your son gave me half his life, and that is a debt I can never repay." While Sekken had managed to head that off at the palace, he knew better than to assume Ryotora would give up, and he couldn't ask the other man not to say anything, not without explaining why. An explanation he hadn't yet mustered the strength to give. So Sekken had to keep the man entertained and away from awkward conversations, all while maintaining the unpredictable balance of his own health. Given the constraints, theater seemed like an ideal diversion. It was indoors, sedentary, and didn't involve talking much to other people, while providing fodder for later conversations. Unfortunately, Ryotora seemed to have no interest in performances of any kind, whether the formal dramas of No or the comic hilarity of Kyogen. Nor did he want to attend wrestling matches, an art that the Phoenix admittedly weren't renowned for. But then again, neither were the dragon. Sekken even unbent enough to suggest perusing the wares in the city's main market, vulgar though that was, but met with an unyielding refusal. Incense? Sekken offered, desperately scraping for an activity Ryotora might enjoy. They put the scents into boxes, and then you see if you can identify which boxes hold the same scent, or guess at the components that went into it. Or there's, comparison parties. Ryotora's brows knit together in confusion. Comparison parties? Yes, where people bring in things like seashells or roots. They write poems to go with them, and then the judges compare the specimens. You know, evaluating them for length and thickness and so forth. And yes, depending on who's judging and how drunk they are, it gets exactly as suggestive as that sounds. Ooh, I've never seen one this large and well-shaped before. Sekken waggled his eyebrows, then sighed. But root comparisons happen during the Iris Festival, and that's months away. He shouldn't have mentioned iris roots. It was too flirtatious, and the conversation got awkward every time it drifted in that direction. They had no opportunity to be private. Such limitations didn't necessarily stop people from having trysts. It was a good third of what Winter Court was for. But those worked better when the people involved weren't Ryotora and Sekken. In Sekken's imagination, a year before, it had seemed so simple. He would undertake to regularly inspect Sable Mura, affording himself and Ryotora plenty of opportunities to enjoy one another's company. But the village was a bone two dogs were fighting over, and with Sekken's health so unreliable, regular trips anywhere were impossible. Meanwhile, his family were doing their utmost to set him up with a politically advantageous spouse, a fact which Ryotora almost certainly knew. Neither of them had said anything yet. They'd never promised one another marriage during those precious golden days when they could consider what they wanted for themselves. They both knew the obstacles in the way of that. While peasants might marry for love, lords rarely could. And now, under the scrutiny of Winter Court rather than free in the wilds of the Dragon Mountains, nothing was simple at all. "What do you do with your spare time?" Sekken asked, scrambling to keep the conversation from tripping over that cliff. "It can't be nothing but duty from morning to night." Surely it couldn't. Not even for Ryotora. The cut planes of Ryotora's face had sharpened even more in the last year. He'd lost weight, and never had much to spare to begin with. But Sekken recognized their hardening as defensive embarrassment, not anger. "It isn't.
I do like to read. Memory swam up from the depths, like a lost koi. Ryotora perusing the library at Ryodo Temple, then falling asleep with a scroll spread across his lap. A little too heartily, Sekken said.
You're in the right part of Rokugan for that. What do you like to read? I already know you'll read medical texts if there's nothing else on offer. But I doubt that's your first choice.
I find the writings of Akudo no Atsuto Noriaya very thought-provoking.
Of course, Ryotora read moral philosophy for fun. Some of Sekken's despair must have shown through, despite his best efforts, because Ryotora added hastily,
I also practice the way of tea.
My father is a devotee, though his collection of utensils is not at all noteworthy.
Sekken couldn't blame his slow arrival at understanding on any weakness in his air or fire. He knew himself. He would have made the same mistake even before Seibo Mura. Ryotora isn't wealthy, you fool. Of course, he didn't want to attend the theater or peruse the market stalls for trinkets to take home. Of course, he lacked familiarity with different blends of incense, whose components could be very expensive indeed. While samurai were supposed to be above the petty concerns of money, that mostly meant that too many of them spent what they didn't have, chasing the pleasures and luxuries the world had to offer. Not Ryotora, of course. He, of all people, would know the limits of his purse and keep stringently within them. Yes, he had an estate now, but given the state of the Dragon Clan, what did that mean? Was it a prosperous farm, or in their lands, more likely to be a productive mine, or a decaying manor outside a depopulated village? Even if the estate produced actual income, Ryotora would be cautious about spending it. Saying that out loud would only shame the man further. Offering to pay for things would be even worse. Sekken floundered for a moment. Then he said, I have an idea. Come with me. Sekken's plan did, unfortunately, involve extended proximity with his eldest sister. On the other hand, he defied even Ryotora to have a meaningful conversation while playing kickball. As he'd suspected, a game was in progress in the palace's western courtyard when he, Ryotora, and Tanshu arrived. There often was at this time of day, with many samurai closeted in meetings. Their bodyguards and escorts were left at loose ends. The sterner ones, and the lazier ones, sat cross-legged in readiness near their charges, but usually at least a few entertained themselves with a game. Ha! The previous kick had lofted the ball off on a wide arc, but Ginsho lunged and managed to send it back with her toe. Sekken, watching, suspected Shiba Tanezane of having deliberately sent it wild. Kemari was supposed to be a cooperative game rather than a competitive one, the players working together to keep the ball aloft. But those two would find a way to compete over breathing if they could. They'd been rivals ever since their school days. Spotting the new arrivals, Ginsho bowed herself out of the game and came trotting over. Little brother, did you need me for something? I hope you weren't planning on joining us. To Ryotora, she confided. Whatever intelligence the fortune saw fit to give him, none of it wound up in his feet. She couldn't have provided Sekken with a more innocuous excuse to bow out if he'd coached her beforehand.
It's true, he said mournfully to Ryotora. But you play Kemari, right? I seem to remember a story about that when we were at Ryodo Temple.
You remember because the story ended with me in a fish pond, Ryotora said wryly. No fish ponds to worry about here, Ginsho said, gesturing at the courtyard. Come, show us what you can do. It was a simple activity, friendly, since Ryotora had no school rivals here, and absolutely free. Sekken even knew he enjoyed it. Why, then, did Ryotora hesitate?
I'll watch from over here, Sekken said, perching himself on the sunlit veranda with Tanshu at his side. Not coincidentally, it took him out of range of any objection Ryotora might make. The man hesitated a moment longer,
but Ginsho was hard to resist. Within a few moments, she had him out on the flagstones, body poised to strike the ball. Sekken breathed a sigh of relief. Social connections achieved, without him having to risk an expenditure of energy that might leave him flat on the ground. Maybe I'll encourage Ryotora to play Kimari all winter. I wouldn't mind watching. Of course, watching called up pleasantly bothersome sights. The air might be cold, but soon the exertion would have Ryotora sweating. Sekken had seen the other man in the bath, and his imagination conjured very vivid images of droplets sliding over that smooth. Lord Isako. Sekken managed not to jump as a shadow fell over him. The newcomer knelt so he wouldn't be staring up toward the sun, and he swallowed a curse.
Vidi Isawa.
Isawa Chikayu arranged herself so they were both looking at the Kimari game, where Ginsho had just lobbed an easy shot toward Ryotora. She was one of his mother's contemporaries, but no hints of age showed in her oval face, her perfectly coiffed hair. It has been difficult to find you not in the immediate company of your dragon friend.
Is there some reason you're reluctant to speak in his presence?
Only that what I say touches on his mission here. Chikayu wasn't the priestess the phoenix wanted to send to supervise the village, but she was one of the most influential Isawa at this court.
I'm afraid the dragon are rather immovable on that point,
Sekken replied, keeping his tone light.
There's a proverb you may have heard, about mountains not stepping aside.
You misunderstand me. I am saying I might be able to help him. Sekken didn't turn his head. He didn't want anyone thinking this conversation was anything other than idle chatter. His gaze remained on the swirling garments of the Kimari players.
You don't support the idea of an Isawa overseer?
A soft breath took the place of a laugh.
I think it would be a good idea, but I also doubt things in Sabomura will go wrong so rapidly that we cannot dispatch assistance if the need arises. The recent problems only occurred because we had no records of what Kaimin Nushi had done there so many centuries ago, and so the destruction of the old shrine passed without comment. That will no longer be a problem.
Assuming Minamoto Kinmoku was doing anything like a good job, she'd probably made the same arguments.
Sekken himself would make them, if there were any way for him to support the dragon side of the debate, without sounding unfaithful to his own clan.
For Chikayu to voice them now, she must have found some more valuable prize the phoenix might attain.
Your trust in the dragon honors them. What might they do to repay it?
Not them, Lord Asako. You. The bright swirls of fabric abruptly tipped and swam. Sekken's fingers dug into his knees, and he didn't care if Chikayu would see and think it a reaction to what she'd said.
No, not now.
But his body didn't care what else might be going on. For days now, his health had been cautiously good, tempting him to think that maybe it would stay that way. It had happened before, and every time his body had eventually betrayed him. A hollow feeling grew inside, as if someone were scooping out the core of Sekken, leaving behind a frail husk.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.